Hi, and welcome to my talk, Green Mining, What Can We Tell Developers? So just to introduce Green Mining, imagine that you have a software change, so you've made a commit. How do you know if that commit can induce a power regression or not? Is it benign to the power use of the software? So when a programmer addresses this problem, they might consider about the different ways to test. First, they could do a regression test. So they could write up a test case, measure it, run it multiple times, measure it again, get stats on that until they get a stable reading, and then understand if they've actually changed anything. Alternatively, they can throw it over the wall and just give it to the end users. This is a pretty common thing as well. Unfortunately, you can really disappoint end users and you can really inconvenience them, and that could cause you market share. Furthermore, another option would be to avoid expensive testing and avoid infuriating users by estimating the power use based upon a corpus of prior runs or a corpus of similar software that allows you to build a model to see if the software you're changing or making matches software that had power regressions in the past. So this is green mining, basically where we take tests of the software and we combine it with static analysis and dynamic analysis so that we can look at the effect of a software change on power consumption. And so we want to produce a corpus of these tests, the purpose of which is basically to allow us to reason about the power consumption of source code changes based on a corpus of power regression tests already run on either the same software or different software. So who might care about this? Well, anyone in academia, in industry, consumers, environmentalists, anyone doing mobile development might care because it might affect their bottom line, or it might affect how long they get to use the software or their machinery. So what are the causes of software power consumption? Well, there's events over time. Events tend to require resources and they tend to require attention. So oftentimes the resources are things like using the Wi-Fi network or, say, interrupts from peripherals, disk I/O, memory, CPU. All of these things which you can use in software tend to lead to software-based power consumption. So essentially it's the developer's responsibility. They are responsible for using these resources, reacting to events, and their choices in how they choose to use these resources can have an effect on the power consumption of the software. So if they choose between pulling or blocking, it can make a big difference. Furthermore, you, the user, have a say in power consumption. You have a say because you have tasks to be done. You can choose to do those tasks or not, but you can also choose between different applications that solve the same problem to fulfill those tasks. Usually you have a choice in this. Your applications that you use usually have alternative applications, and they can have different kinds of properties with respect to power. So in the first column here, we've got text editing, and we've got Gedit and LibreOffice and Google Docs. If we look at their maximums, we can see that Gedit uses less than LibreOffice, which uses less than Google Docs. For email, we've got a comparison of Thunderbird to Gmail. And for music playing, we've got two different music players. So you can see that different players have different properties in terms of power. This is interesting because there's also a minimum. There's an idle performance. This idle power consumption is interesting. It's basically like ghost power or Viper power. It's just the process running. Perhaps it's checking on things, perhaps it's checking for events. That kind of stuff can sap your battery. What's even worse is you didn't ask the software to do anything, it's just sitting around. And just sitting around many times causes the software to actually consume power. Here's an example. So we've got Vuz, it's a BitTorrent client. And we're going to set it to seed a file for 10 minutes. So this is sort of an average use case. If you just want to upload something, but maybe there's no uploaders, you're going to sit around idle for about 10 minutes. So we've got two plots here. The one at the top is watts versus time. At the start, we start up Vuz, it initializes, it verifies that you have the file, and then it seeds the file. We can see that it's pretty stable during seeding, but also what's concerning is it's above 21 watts, whereas 19 was our base idle watts. So it's basically using 2 extra watts per time unit to seed a file. It's not really doing anything, it's waiting for connections. Whereas if it does seed, or if it does download or seed the file, it tends to use a lot more. So you're responsible as a user, but you can also make other trade-offs. You can decide if you're going to trade off usability for more battery life, or perhaps you're going to trade off money. What if you want to use software that is for free, but you're willing to pay for it with your battery? You're willing to serve power sapping ads. So there are many options. Some are to use more power in order to get something for free. So then we wanted to see what questions programmers actually ask about power. So they ask, we found on Stack Overflow that they ask things like, is my Android app draining the battery? Reducing the battery of input, battery. How do we reduce the battery impact of applications that download content over smartphone radio? Which one's better for power, PHP or Java? Does multi-car hyper-threaded code use more power? So these were all questions that were seen on Stack Overflow that programmers asked. And of course, Stack Overflow allows people to give answers. So some answers included use power top, basically a nice estimator of how much a process uses, suspend peripherals, like the mouse, the keyboard, modems, anything like that, avoid polling, use blocking, reduce updates, reduce timeouts. But not all of the suggestions were good. For instance, one suggestion was that they shouldn't worry about the timer because it doesn't use power, although the GPU, CPU do. They do use power. The problem here is that if the timer causes the program to wake up, to be rescheduled by the operating system to run, then it does use power because it used the, it told the operating system it had to wake up to address this issue. So programmers do know some things about power. They do ask questions about power, but they don't always have good expertise and they don't always have good advice. So here's some general advice we can pull out. Basically, if your software is CPU intensive, you should just try to reduce the amount of time the software is running. Just reduce that integration. If your software is mostly idle, you want to make sure that your idle events don't have a lot of wake-ups and you're not asking to be rescheduled very often. If you're idle, you should probably try to stay idle. Furthermore, if you're idle in terms of disk I/O, you should probably just try to return the number of events. You want to avoid waking up the disks. Spinning disks often go to sleep, and to wake them up costs a lot more power. If your software uses the network, you want to avoid using the network. Sometimes packaging things up in the bigger packets will save more power than sending out lots of little packets and lots of little responses. But it depends on the context. Furthermore, if your software is event intensive, you can consider relying on an efficient OS-aware event loop and look for alternatives to polling or making new events. Can you bunch events up so that when you are given context, you can immediately act? Furthermore, if you program something like, say, a map program or a music player, you should be very careful about asking the OS not to be put asleep. So anytime you're asking the OS to not do its normal power saving stuff, that is a big code smell that you've got a problem, or you have a potential problem. So it was all interesting, but what can we do right now? How can mining software repositories help programmers right now? Well, programmers don't have information about their programs right now. They want to act. So MSR can help by doing the hard stuff. The testing, the measurement is hard. So what we can do is we can do the measurement, the collection, the testing, the modeling, and the estimation in order to help provide contextual estimates to end developers so they can actually address power without a lot of pain. So in conclusion, your software should stay asleep, don't wake it up. We want to make sure that idle processes don't consume power, because they do. But ultimately, the choices you make as a user affect your battery life of your software. Furthermore, contextual estimates matter. So developers want to see contextual estimates, and they don't want to run regression tests. Thanks. Bye.